For this moment in the politics of the transition and what's ahead, let's bring in White House correspondent Karen Travers for more. Karen, you're covering the Trump White House and the Biden transition, and I know you are looking into both. So who else might we hear being named to cabinet positions in the Biden administration? What does it tell you about what we're looking at?
Big announcements from the president-elect Joe Biden. And I think what it says is that he is first just plowing ahead, even as President Trump is not conceding this race, and he is getting ready to step in on January 20th. There's also the sense of stability from some of these picks. These are people who have long experience in these positions. Joe Biden says they are crisis-tested, and they're people that have ties to him. So let's start out with a couple of them. You have Alejandro Mayorkas, picked to be the Secretary of Homeland Security. He is an immigrant. Born in Cuba, brought here as a refugee by his parents, he would be the first Latino to serve in that position. The president-elect has also tapped Avril Haines to be the Director of National Intelligence. And Terry, she would be the first woman to lead the intelligence community. You mentioned Linda Thomas-Greenfield. She'll be the ambassador to the United Nations if she is confirmed. And Tony Blinken as Secretary of State. And Blinken is somebody that is a very known quantity here in Washington. He's somebody that has very long ties to Joe Biden. He worked with him back on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. He was a top foreign policy advisor to Joe Biden when he was the vice president. He later served as the deputy secretary of state, so he knows his way around Foggy Bottom, and the people there know him very well. These are all very critical positions for national security and foreign policy. And Terry, of course, as you know, all of these positions have to be confirmed by the Senate.
Right, in the hands of Republicans so far. We'll see how those Georgia runoffs go. And also signs of continuity there, almost like a third Obama term, a lot of those people coming out of the Obama administration. Let's turn now to the current president, what he's up to. Most Republicans calling for President Trump to concede the election. What are you hearing from the White House?
Well, the president still has shown no signs of conceding this race. But, Terry, he's really showing no signs of doing much of anything recently. He's had four events in the 3 weeks since Election Day, and over the weekend was mostly spending his time at his golf course out in Virginia. This, of course, is coming as there are more prominent Republicans now saying that the way his team is playing out this legal process is not going well, just stating the reality there. Chris Christie, an advisor, a close confidant of the president, says that his legal team is a national embarrassment. You had the Republican governor of Maryland, Larry Hogan, say it's embarrassing that Republicans aren't stepping up and telling the president the reality and blocking or trying to interfere in his efforts now to overturn these election results. We'll see what happens over the coming days, but the president is expected to be very quiet at the White House ahead of the Thanksgiving holiday.
Getting in more golf, no doubt. And I misspoke there. I said most Republicans. It's more Republicans, like Chris Christie and others, are coming out. The Trump campaign's cutting ties with one of those attorneys that have been working with him. Sidney Powell put on quite a show at that press conference with Rudy Giuliani last week, making a series of really false and crazy claims, including that Georgia's Republican governor, Brian Kemp, a staunch Trump supporter, was all part of a massive election conspiracy. The campaign's now lost 30 court cases along the around the country. How long can this go on?
Yeah, I mean, they're losing round after round in court at this point. And, you know, there have been some stunning moves by the Trump White House and the Trump campaign, but distancing themselves from a lawyer who stood at the RNC last week with two of the president's attorneys and saying she's not a part of our team really ranks up in the top five, I think, of really incredulous moments from this group. Sidney Powell clearly crossed a line there by claiming there was a Venezuelan plot to take away the election from the president, and the Republican governor of Georgia was involved in this. Terry, you kind of get this sense that at this point, given how much they're losing in court and some of the scathing statements from these judges, they're not just getting them dismissed, they're getting smacked down in court, too, that some of this just seems aimed at appeasing the president, kind of, you know, showing him we're doing something, even if the writing is on the wall that this is not going to go anywhere. Now, how long can this go? They can say they're going to keep filing appeals, but states are starting to certify their elections. We saw Georgia do that at the end of last week. Michigan's Board of Canvassing is they're meeting today, deciding whether or not they're going to certify that race. And we'll see going forward, Pennsylvania, Nevada, Wisconsin, all in the coming days will be doing the same. That could be the end of the road for the president and his legal case.
The clock is ticking for the gang that couldn't sue straight, as somebody said. Karen Travers at the White House, thanks so much.
Hi, everyone. George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to download the ABC News app for breaking news alerts. Thanks for watching.